Turning my way. I have cried sometimes. Yeah, it's so much trouble again. It makes me cry sometimes. Yeah, it'll be awake at night.
Lord, soul and I heard the voice of my Jesus say, come on, come on to me. Hey, you can rest. Oh, yeah. He said, I'll never back down. I will live. We can be one. Oh, one.
Is in my heart to serve the Lord. Let me see a show of hands of those who are visiting with us this morning, please. Amen. Would you please stand? Would you please stand? We have a special song for you.
You are welcome, welcome, you.
The song you decide to sing, it won't be very long.
Thank you. If this was Sam Bailey experience every Sunday, he would spoil everything. And you tell Sam, when you record this, that I better not hear him complain about Cedar Valley. Praise the Almighty. Unto him that is able to do immeasurably more. And we ever ask him, imagine more. And to him be the power, the glory, and the praise. I've had an awesome experience this morning. It's been so long since I've experienced an authentic worship. I know you know that. I know that young man over there. Praise God. His mom, his grandmother here. Yeah, I remember. I remember. It has shown up a long way from the clay hills and the prairie and the cotton fields of Abilene, Texas. But the Lord uprooted us and told us to go to Dallas, and so I came to Dallas. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let me say just a few things about Sam Bailey, because I believe it's very appropriate. In a time where our gospel has been hitchhiked by a prosperity doctrine, in a time where preachers are no longer prophetic, but they are puppet, it is good to know that I have a comrade in the gospel who authentically loves the Lord. It is evident because God will bless your ministry. It is evident because God will bless your church. And let me say this to you, Cedar Valley, that you are a prosperous church. And I'm not talking about prosperous in the financial way. I'm talking about you are rich in the spiritual. You're rich in the spiritual realm. I went to Southwestern with Sam. I met Sam years ago, and after that, we sung together. I was in tour with Shannon Bailey. He's my summer tour brother. I started just a little bit later than what some did after college. I wasn't going to college. I said I wasn't going to do it. But the Lord knows how to disrupt your life, doesn't he? And he put me on the first thing, smoking the Texas in Florida. Praise God. And let me say this, Sam has been committed to the cross ever since the day I met him. And I want to challenge you this morning, Cedar Valley, to take care of your preacher.
Amen. Amen.
Take care of your preacher.
Yes, sir.
It is hard to come across good men. Around this brotherhood, churches are slipping. We have fallen away from the authentic teachings of the gospel. Egos have ripped through our pews. Bickering and church fighting has now become lectureship themes. And we are losing members at a rapid rate. Souls are dying in the streets. And souls are dying in our congregation. But it's good to know that I can step into a church and come to Cedar Valley and to know that God reigns supreme at this place. Amen. I'm waiting for you in Luke chapter 17. In the words of the old preacher, I won't be long, but I will be strong. Luke chapter 17. I want to thank everybody who has participated thus this far to make this worship experience an awesome experience. If you have a smartphone, turn your Bible to Luke chapter 17. And if you want to take notes, go to the notes section. And if you're old school Church of Christ, and I don't need to bring my phone into the church, even though people get mad at me for not doing it. I'm just an old note taker, so if you got a paper and pencil, just write something down that inspires you. Luke chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. On the way to Jerusalem, he was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered the village, he was met by 10 lepers. And underscore this in your Bible, who stood at a distance. And he lifted up their voices and saying, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. When he saw them, he said to them, show yourselves to the priest. And as he went, they were cleansed. Then one of them saw that he was healed and turned back, praising God with a loud voice. Verse 16 says, and he fell on his face at the feet of Jesus. And he fell on his face at the feet of Jesus. Giving thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Watch Jesus' response. Then Jesus answered, were not 10 clean? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? And he said unto them, rise and go your way. Your faith has made you whole. This morning I want to speak on the subject, if I can use as a title, spiritual amnesia. Spiritual amnesia. Pray with me, please. Father in heaven, that we call upon your divine spirit and nature to move into this place, to come into our hearts. Renovate us from things that are not like you. Change us from the person that we once were into the being that you would have us to be. Allow your spirit to permeate this worship, sir. Allow your gospel the power to change our lives. Father, let us not become arrogant to your throne. But let us cast aside every weight and sin that so easily besets us, so that within the pure spirit, in the authentic heart, that we worship you. We understand that we must decrease, so that you may have the increase. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable unto thee. And for those who have been washed, saved, and believe in the gospel and the power of Jesus Christ, let us say together, amen.
Amen.
Amnesia, by definition, meaning without memory, is a deficient in the memory caused by brain damage, disease, or psychological trauma. Amnesia can also be caused by temporarily by the use of various sedatives and drugs. Essentially, amnesia is a loss of memory. The memory can be either wholly or partial loss due to the extent of damage that was caused. There are two main types of amnesia. The first one is retrograde amnesia. And the second is antrograde amnesia. Retrograde amnesia is the inability to retrieve information that was required before a particular date, usually the date of an accident or operation. In some cases, memory loss can extend back decades, while in others, the person may lose only a few months of memory. Now, antrograde amnesia is the inability to transfer new information from the short term to the long term. People with this type of amnesia cannot remember things for long periods of time. These two types are not mutually exclusive, but both can occur within a patient at one time. In comparison, this disease has struck many of us without warning, especially within the large church. In modern society, we are living in a time that we have forgotten how to remember God and what God has done for us, even as of yesterday. I can recall a time that you were not afraid to tell them thank you publicly. But now we find ourselves embarrassed to say grace for the food that he's blessed us with. There was a time when God blessed you publicly and you couldn't hold it in the anticipation. You just had to tell the world how good God was. But now you just simply shrug it off. The church has come down with the symptoms of retrograde amnesia. There was a time that you were grateful for the little bit you had. You didn't complain about the stuff that you got. You said, thank you, Lord, and I'll be grateful. You didn't complain about what the church looked like and whether or not we had a nice microphone system or the fellowship hall. You just wanted somewhere to praise God. You forgot in your long term that God of your grandmother's prayer is what got you through. But now, you come into the house of God complaining about how hard the pews are. And the fact that the air conditioner is not blowing cold enough. You forgot in your memory that the church was a safe place for disconnected souls. And if you couldn't find anywhere to call home, you can always come to the house of God to find refuge. Or just maybe you're suffering from the antrograde amnesia. The inability to remember how God delivered you from yourself. You know, like the short-term memory with things that are too ashamed to even for me to address, and the places that I've been, the stuff that I've done to shame my family, to shame my church. The times you will find yourselves in dark corners, like the prodigal son's hall here. The guilty party circle that the woman caught in adultery was in. The arrogance of the rich young ruler, the social class of the publican. The lying, stealing, cheating ways of a midget named Zacchaeus. Have you forgotten that the same God that delivered them is the same God that delivered you? Yes, I think I know what the problem is, Sheila Valley. I believe that the problem is that we are struggling with spiritual ingratitude. You know, that spirit of lack of appreciation that someone has never fails but to offend the person who is sacrificing. The spirit in which I'm talking about is an ungrateful spirit. In other words, it's your rudeness. Your rudeness not to see how far we went to go out of our way to help you in your helpless condition. All I ever wanted was not to be paid back, but I just wanted to thank you. I just wanted you to know that what I'm doing for you. And it's taking time out to consider you and your needs when nobody else would. I think, church, we have come down with the fever of spiritual amnesia. So in the text, we have a group of needy individuals who are in the need of God and his miraculous healing. In Luke chapter 17, we find 10 lepers who are in desperate need of a divine intervention. They are considered the cast downs of society. They are considered those people. You know those people. They are considered as literally the untouchables. Leprosy and all of this debilitating disease, and it eats you from the inside out. Leprosy, that sickness that you couldn't hide if you tried. Can you imagine the boils on the tongue that sits in the pockets of pus erupting all over your body, and there's not a moment of peace? Leprosy. Leprosy is a disease that is considered that you are dead while yet living. Because there was no cure. Can you just imagine people, young as well as old, having to remove themselves from their families in whom love escorted them out of the outskirts of the city? And they can no longer be a part of society. the doctor coming in and saying that your baby had been diagnosed with leprosy. You got to let him go. Family members having a hard time separating for loved ones because they know that they can no longer participate with them. They are the castabouts. You know, the people that walk past you and they start whispering. They start to cut their eyes at you, saying, I remember when that boy was all right. Look at him now. The untouchables. When people know you're stuck and you are in shame and nobody wants to fellowship with you. The untouchables. I don't know if you ever experienced that before.
Yes, sir.
They're human.
Yes.
These broken people who had to create camps miles outside of the city so they wouldn't contaminate others. They could not talk, touch, or come into contact with anyone or anything. They were just left out there to die. They were what you call now the walking dead. And if I could bring this into modern society, into the 21st century, there are communities of individuals who have been considered having a mental breakdown and are living in California on what we call skid row. You know the folk that you drive by in your car and you lock your door on Martin Luther King Boulevard? This is people. And excuse me if I lose my candor and my professionalism just a little bit. When I first got down to Dallas, I was driving around and looking for some places to eat. And a friend of mine, he said, I know where the place to go. I said, well, man, we got nothing but time and opportunity. Let's go. He said, I'm going to take you to a special place in Oak Cliff. And I said, all right. And we drove up there. That's what it was. And we drove up there. And there was a street called Ledbetter, I believe it was. Was it Ledbetter? Some of you may have grown up on Ledbetter. It ain't nothing wrong with Ledbetter. If you from Ledbetter, be from Ledbetter. Jesus was from the south side of Nazareth. Drive through there not without locking your door if you want to. I'm talking about let's go back to the cocaine AIDS era. Rob you in broad daylight. But as we drove and we went around town, we went to some soul food place off of Ledbetter. My soul became dim because I saw streets of people who've lost their way. And for some reason, the light of their life has dimmed. There were 6 liquor stores on one street. It was obvious that people were struggling with some chemical dependency. It was obvious that young ladies was out there selling their bodies. It was obvious that young men had been evangelized in the cult of thuggism. The word wasn't supposed to be this tough this morning. The untouchable. Those places where the government didn't want to touch us. You know, the cities in which young people are starting to get strung out on drugs, living homeless with no hope for their addiction. On the outskirts of the city, they cannot get in because we've shut them out. We don't want their kind in here with us. We don't want their kind in our neighborhood. They will bring our stuff down. We don't want to deal with those type of people. You know, the people on the outskirts, the people who are living with the secret of HIV. That universal epidemic that has ferociously torn through our society, fabric leaving us with no ends of hope for a cure. And if I can go a little bit deeper this morning. The society of our gay children who have been outcast by families. That young lady who lost her identity and now she thinks that her identity is a man, so therefore she dresses up like a little boy. Our sons who are losing their identity because fathers
I'm not at home to give the proper instruction. And now,
I'm not here to talk against nobody. I'm talking about the human fallacy of our humanity that Jesus desires to restore. The young men who are in the penitentiary working up to 25 years to life, and they come out of jail not knowing where they are, not knowing how to start over. These are our children. The societies of the inductions. The shame of their lifestyle. They are excommunicated them from the family without love, without any hope of redemption. The untouchable communities are the far out crowds. The crowds that we the saved are ashamed of, because many of us have once been there ourselves. And in order to acknowledge this, I've got to acknowledge where I once been myself. I know that you all saved and sanctified. You're looking good. You're smelling good. You come up here. You got your hair weave in and you're looking good. Brother, you all suited up. You booted up. But that wasn't always you. You ain't always had it together. You ain't always had good credit. Talk back to me. Now you got your German car now with your helicopter engine in it, and it takes synthetic oil. You somebody now. You got your own personal and private tailor. You somebody now. But did you forget that at one time we were so broke we had to share bathwater? You want to talk about that? Big Mama said, don't let that water out. Get in there, sir. They rang off. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. So verse 20, we come to the text. In Greek measurements, an object is always measured from the beholder, meaning that our issue of sin puts us in a distance from Jesus. It's never Jesus that is afar off. It is us who is afar off from God. It was never God that separated himself from man, but it's always been man that separated himself from God. These lepers were not the only far off crowd that was in this text. They had to be behind the poor people. The crowds that followed God in the first century context is that the lepers had to live the furthest out. And so you also had some other people who had issues, and they can live close to the city. Uh-huh. But the lepers couldn't live there. They had to be behind the poor folk. Uh-huh. It was so messed up, they couldn't even touch the poor people. Uh-huh. And none of them was eating. Can you imagine not even the poor people not wanting you near? And all of y'all messed up together? And we got the nerve to step in some of our churches to write our names on the pews. This is where I sit. I've been given the longest in this here church. I've been serving in the kitchen longer than anybody up in here. And we forget that we all mess up. I heard it was one preacher that said, Christianity is nothing but one beggar telling another beggar what a bread. You all beggars. Let me include myself in that. We all beggars. Sin. Sin. And write this in your mental blackboard. Sin brings about isolation. When we are embarrassed from our flaws of life, we have a tendency to step back and to disengage. That's why the book says, forsake not the assembly of the gathering of yourselves. Do you know why we come here every Sunday, Lord's Day, and sometimes Monday through Saturday? Because we need to be inspired by each other. Man, you ain't the only one out there struggling on something. Sister, you ain't the only one that got an issue in your life. When we come together, we speak life into each other. We tell each other that we love one another. And we tell each other that we're going to make it together.
Hallelujah.
You got the nerve for God to deliver you out of something? And the only thing that you're going to do is sit up here and smack on your gum while the worship is on. With your legs crossed and you feel that you can't worship. And God has brought you out of sight. He saved you out of sight. He spared your marriage. Matter of fact, He spared your life. And we got the nerve to come up in God's house as if we are on something. Y'all quit bothering me. I need to finish my text here. Isolation, and please write this down and put it in your mental blackboard, is the act of separating something from other things. It was Isaiah 59 verse 2 that said, but your iniquities have separated you from the God that we serve. Because of your sins, He has turned away from you. Verse 13 gives us an internal view of what's going on. The lepers were considered dead to society. Can you imagine what it feels like for the society to give up on you? Can you imagine what it is to wake up every morning to know that I don't fit in nowhere, that nobody wished good for me, that nobody wants the best for me?
All right, preacher.
Among African Americans, and I taught at a college for several years, among African American males, suicide is the third leading cause of death. And there was a time when we didn't do stuff like that. But now the ages among them, watch this now, is from 15 to 35. I just turned 36 in September. I am 1 year removed from that statistic. 15 to 35 are now on the rising rate of suicide. What is going on in our society? What are we missing? I don't know about everybody else. I'm talking about my children, our children. In the words of Marvin Gaye, what's going on? Tired of going to lectureships, and the only thing we can fight about is these other churches where one man uses a baseline. Is that all that you got? Is that all that you think about? Marriages are tearing up in the church, and you got the nerve to fly me down in November to talk about that. Over 80% of African American males from the ages of 15 to 30 have a fetter or in the penile system. Do you know what that means for us as a community? If that's the age group of productivity, if that's the age group that's going to lead us in the next 20 to 30 years into the dimension that we need to be, and all them fellas, they can't get jobs, they ain't got insurance, what do you think is going to happen to us? But we ain't talking about that. You're majoring in all the minors. Is that what we're doing? I'm talking about dead to society. If we are not attentive to the needs of others, they will create their own communities. I was in Dallas. I was in downtown Dallas the other day, riding with one of my police officer friends. And he was just breaking it down to me. He said, this is where this area is. This is a predominant black area. But this area here is LGBTQ. Don't judge. I'm dealing with some stuff here now. The Bible says for those who are deep, they call us upon the deep. And we've got to learn to minister to everybody, even if you don't like that particular sin. Somebody don't like your particular sin. They have a community to themselves. And it's to the point where they recognize that they don't need nobody coming in and mishandling them. That is a direct response to the inadequacy of the church. In communities, you have to be careful about this, which only transfers and invite more sickness. We got to be careful about that.
Yes, sir.
I've come to realize that it is something for society to give up on you.
Yes.
But for the church, the place of the redeemed, the church of our Lord and Savior, and my Bible says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died. God loved you enough while you was getting high, selling your body out there in the street. God loves you through that. And your private addictions, your private behaviors, you barely made it out. The folk that you used to run with, they all dead, but you still alive. You got the nerve to tell me that you can't love me, that you can't share the gospel of how God delivered you.
Preach, Bowman, preach. You preaching, man.
What's wrong with us?
Wake up.
What's wrong with us? At the church, lost its salt. Have we lost the power of this God who intervened in my life and saved me from some stuff? The same God that saved you from your stuff. And that young person sit up on that pew by themselves and they steal along when they walk out of here. Leprosy. I need to hurry up and end this thing. Leprosy gradually, watch this, gradually destroys the voice. But then the ten could still make a considerable amount of noise, so many that they were hoarse because the pockets of pus would go into their vocal cords, and it was a weird sound. Thousands of lepers making a weird sound at one time, but this weird sound got the attention of Jesus. It was an unorthodox type of praise that they were doing. You know, you all offended by somebody clapping their hands in front of you, and you don't know the hell and high water in which they had to come out of this morning to make it here. Leprosy. Watch this now. The cries from the outsiders was going to sound strange because of the sickness. See, the cries of sick people is an unusual language. But for some reason, Jesus understood the linguistics of what they were saying. I'm so blessed to the fact that when nobody else understood, I got a God that listened. And I had a God that responded. I had a God that came down and said, this power that is within me, I give it to you. Aren't you glad that God could hear you cry when nobody else could? What is your prayer? Many of us, before we have a prayer, we have a complaint to God. But in this case, the lepers were not content with their condition, nor were they immune to their situation. They didn't saturate in their sorrow, and they didn't marinate in their misery. And they said, this is my one and only time to catch the mess. This is my time. As messed up as I am, I can't be concerned about everybody else's opinion. I've got to touch the foot of God. But in this case, the lepers were not content with their condition, nor were they immune to their situation. Many of us have become immune to our condition of sin, and so therefore, we die slowly.
Yes, yes.
Many of us have given up and have accepted the fate of what we think that we have been given. Jesus said, I have come so that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Meaning that I have come so that you can live, that you may live, that you may live. You deserve to live because I died. Aren't you glad?
Yes.
That God didn't give up on you when you gave up on us. Aren't you glad?
Yes.
When you was considering ending it all, walking out of the marriage, walking out of the children's lives, going back to the substance, going back to that vice.
All right. Yes.
The sweet voice of God said, live. What got me was that the leper colony was a very large one. Because of this was a common disease in Middle Eastern times. And sometimes it was up to hundreds of thousands of lepers living in one colony. When the leper came to Jesus, I believe it's verse 13 that said, they shouted out with the little bit of voice they had left, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. It's a shame when sick folk can make a community for themselves. And the church has an individuality complex. They came to pray for each other. Well, it's come to us. It's my God. See, in Greek times, in the translation, I don't want to get too far in that because they ain't going to help us. But I just want to give us a meeting. It's translated, only Jesus is to free us. Free us from this infirmity. Free us from the sickness. The lepers believed that Jesus could heal. And verse 13, Jesus responds to the lepers. Watch this. And the modern day lepers, and let's include ourselves in that. So when Jesus saw them, he told them to go show yourself to the priest. We got a problem. We got a problem. We got a problem. Now remember in the Leviticus letter, the law of cleanliness, that the lepers could not touch. They could not be around. And if they were to come around, they had to yell out, I am leper. I am leper. I am leper. Can you imagine walking around and shouting and confessing your private sin? Can you imagine going around and before I step in the room, I'm telling everybody the real me? Can you imagine? Folks don't want to hear that this morning, and you walk into church and say, Lord, I'm a gambler. I need help this morning, Father. I got a gambling problem. I gambled away the rent money. I gambled away the grocery money. My wife is leaving. My children don't have respect for me. Help me. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? Here is the problem. Write this down. I gotta hurry up. Here's the problem. Number one, it was an unorthodox command. The first problem was that they had to show themselves to the priest. The priest was inside the city. They outside the city. The priest is inside the city, right? They can't come into the city, right? We don't want your kind here. Don't come around here no more. You sick. You messed up. Don't come in here. And if you come in here, I'll kill you. By the Leviticus letter, they had the right to kill lepers who were coming in, and if they have the nature to contaminate other folk. But look what Jesus said.
Come on. Come
He said, look here. All of you.
All of you.
Go show yourselves to the priest. Mm-hmm. Now, this is where God would have lost. This is where a lot of us would have lost. What did he just say? Jesus said, go show, we got to show ourselves to the priest. They'll kill us before we get to the door. And if I can really be honest with you, if half of them lepers were black, they would have been sick to the day. Let me get back to the text. It is. Both of these could have got them automatically killed. This is where many of us would have missed our blessing. Jesus gave them a command without stopping or showing them attention. The Bible says that Jesus didn't even turn around. He said, look, go show yourself to the priest. And he went back to healing folk. Why, brother minister? I want to show you this now. God understands that if you can go out of your way to get to him, you can take it to the next level. All right. I got to close. All right. See, and write this down. What makes you blessed is not how you grab the healing, but it's how you attach yourself to the healer. There's a lot of people that come into the proximity of God every Sunday and walk out of here just as messed up as they came in. Let me see if I can put them this side. This is an amen corner over here. Right? There's a lot of folks that come to church Sunday after Sunday, year after year, with the same messed up stuff, and they never get help for it. You're in the presence of God, but you refuse to be delivered. Is that all right? It's like somebody showing up to the unemployment office without the intentions of working. What makes you blessed is not how you grab the healer, but it's how you attach yourself to the healer. Not the healing, but the healer. What Jesus was showing them was that your healing, your blessing is based on how well you follow his instructions. Let me say that again. What Jesus was showing them was that your healing and your blessing is based upon how well you follow my instructions. They had to make a choice. Right then. And there either they meet the faith of the folk in the city, or they trust Jesus. It is. Some of us are struggling this morning. Because you value people's opinion about you over God's. And you're going home, crying yourself to sleep at night every Sunday, every Monday, every Tuesday, saying that nobody loves you because you value people's opinion. And let me tell you something, people's opinion cannot deliver you. One more, I'm over time. Can I just, I got a little bit, can I just give you that? I'm going over time, and tell Sam to dot me off pay, do what you need to do, but somebody need to be delivered this morning. Whenever God does something outward, your response should be inward gratitude. Verse 14. As they went, they were cleansed. God blesses us, watch this, while we are in action.
What messed me up was, it's when they came to Jesus and they said, Lord, have mercy, only you can deliver us from this. I said, should they have been healed right then and there? I'm confused about this, Jesus. I know who you are, and I'm not questioning your faith practices. I'm not questioning your inability, but I just want to know why they had to go in the city first. As they went, they were cleansed. God wants to know if we are serious about this. Write this down. Put it in your mental blackboard. Write on your mental blackboard. The greatest compliment that you could ever give the gospel of Jesus Christ. Watch this. The greatest compliment that you could ever give the gospel of Jesus Christ is change. The greatest compliment that you can ever give this gospel is change. Your life changed. Your thinking changed. Your attitude changed. The way I talk changed. My ability to love you changed. It is. God, watch this. Verse 14. Invites them back in community. God understood that the enemy got you. It is. The two things that the devil used to get us is discouragement and isolation. Amen. The Bible says, so then faith cometh by
hearing,
and hearing by
word.
So therefore my faith is developed in my imagination. Right about it. See, the devil just don't want you through sickness and stuff. The devil comes after you because he wants your faith, the very thing that connects you to God. If he can get that, he's got you. Lord have mercy. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for being who you are. The lepers, like many of us, had to face the question, will I commit social suicide? Will I come to God? The command in Leviticus letter was that here it is, and Jesus obeyed the law. You have to go show yourself to the priest. And once the priest finds that you are clean, it is he who gives you permission to come back into community. But only one came back. It is. Nine of them had their faith increased, but one got his soul saved. Nine of them, when they got their need met, they forgot about the one who saved. One of them stopped to worship. And that one was a Samaritan. Can I put this in our language? And excuse for brothers and sisters that is not a part of our culture. He wasn't even black. Everybody left. And the one that came back wasn't even one of us. Everybody that you knew and who knew you, they left without saying thank you, without showing some form of gratitude. But only one came back. And he was had. He wasn't even a member of the church. Lord. You ran out of here. to the check from the deacons, paid the rent, got caught up, came found you. Called and called and called. We didn't want payment back. We just want to see that you're all right. Won't even pick up the phone. See you in Walmart. You turn the other way. And I know there ain't none of y'all. But it never fails how we can call on God when we're down and out. But when we get up, we forget. In conclusion, there's a story. Sometime a while ago, I was boarding the flight and I passed through the first class on my way to sit in the coach. While I was boarding the plane, underneath my breath, I was singing, "Jesus, you are the center of my joy." Yeah. While singing this song, an elderly woman sitting in first class stopped me and she said, "Sir, I hear you singing that song. And I'm not feeling so well. Do you mind praying for me?" And right there, everybody's putting their stuff up. You got 50 people that need to get on the plane. She said, "Would you pray for me?" Right there, I prayed for her, and the elderly woman saved me. And when I went to my seat in the coach section, I began to. I've been assigned the last seat in the back by the bathroom. You know that seat. I end up buckling myself in, and I got my book that I was going to read. And the flight attendant, before the plane lifted off, she said to me, "Sir, I'm not supposed to do this, but I saw you praying for that lady in first class. And I just thought if anybody ought to be in first class, it ought to be you. It ought to be you." And I'm talking to somebody who is holding on to the pew right now, and you're just about to give up because you're too tired to face tomorrow. God died so you can put you in first class. You a first class type of person. You a first class type of person. You a first class type of individual that I would die for. That's the gospel. That is the gospel. You know you are unworthy, but God died so that you can make your worth. It's the blood. We don't preach about the blood no more. That crimson flow that cleans us from all impurity. The blood that washes away sin. The blood. While they stretched them high and they hung them wide. The blood that came out of his side when they pierced him. The blood. That's the thing that consummated my salvation. And I offer that same salvation to you this morning. Who in here needs God to intervene in their life? Who in here needs God to change their narrative? Who in here needs God to change your situation? We don't need a song. Just get up where you are and come down to the first. Brothers, get on up. I'm old school. Get on up. Let them come down to this first row right here. If you need God, come on down. Come on down. You've been hiding too long. You've been hiding too long. You've been struggling too long. If you need God, come on down. God is waiting to deliver you. God is waiting to change you. You ain't got to die in your position. I don't care what folks say about you and your job. I don't care what folks say about you in your house. I don't care what folks say about you in society. You know that's in me. I need him. We need him. And in order for us to get to the place of salvation, he wants to meet you where you are. You can't get it together before you meet God. Because you can't get it together without God. The invitation is now extended. There's a song, brother. Stand. Stand.
Thank you, Lord.
God cares. God cares. Don't mind your neighbor. Don't mind your neighbor. Just say, "I need to get out. I need to give to God. I don't want to die like this." I don't want to deal with another day that I've done. God wants.
I've been through